We don't know if we're live or not.
Live.
Are we live? Hello, everyone. Good morning. And excuse me, here we are again. I'm sorry, I'm still trying to get rid of this, all of the stuff that's this pneumonia is still hanging on in the background there. So if I cough a bit and stutter a bit, please forgive me. So today, first of all, we'd like to say hello to my spirit guide, Grey Eagle, who is always with me and standing to my right side. And we're also going to say hello to my assistant, Carolyn, who is sitting further to the right. Say good morning, Carolyn.
Good morning, everyone.
So here we are, and we do have quite a few questions. But the topic, we are going to carry on from last week's topic, which was dealing with relationships. And we're going to be talking a little bit about how to deal with and how to build relationships, how to build relationships from the beginning. For those of you who, you know, are not in a relationship, perhaps have been in a relationship in the past and it didn't work out and you're now on your own. And also, you know, sort of one or two little tips for those people who are in relationships but are struggling in those relationships. And again, we're not just talking about relationships, love, romantic relationships. We're talking about any and every relationship that you can possibly imagine exists. So the relationship with my puppy, the relationship with my grandson, the relationship with my daughter, they are the three relationships that most concern me. My relationships in work, my relationship with Carolyn, if you have good relationships, you get on well, you can become more productive in the work environment. There is nothing worse than working in an environment day after day after day with someone who you simply don't get along with. And I'm sure a lot of you will, you know, get that and say, oh yeah, you know, tell me about it. So first of all, building relationships. And we talked last week about soul signs. We've had a lot of emails from people saying, I don't know what I am and who I am. I don't know if I'm this soul or that soul or the other soul. I can't figure out my soul sign. So let's talk about soul signs for a little bit. Just the basics of soul signs. And again, I'm going to remind you, we have five soul groups. And they are earth, fire, water, and air. And then we have that last, the fifth, which we're going to ignore from now on at this point, which is the sulfur, the group of sulfur. And that I'm sure many of you can imagine that that group, the sulfur sign, are those who are the dark souls. We call them dark souls, which we're not going to even entertain or go forward to talking about today. Maybe in the future we will, but not today. All right, so we have those four soul groups. Again, air, water, fire, and earth. And yes, it does sound a little bit as if we're talking about astrology, but we are not talking about astrology. This has got nothing to do with astrology. Although the similarities, you know, sometimes, you know, are quite amazing, although shouldn't be amazing because everything on this planet connects to everything else and all energy melts together. So, but soul signs is not based on the planetary system and it is not based on our astrological signs. So within these four soul groups, let's go with the earth signs first. If you are an earth sign, every group has three choices. If you are an earth sign, you are that planner, that list maker. And not only do you make lists, you follow through with them. You go from, not always from the top to the bottom, but you work it out and you make sure. Earth signs are those doers. We're the ones who make the lists and then we get the lists done and we go down the lists until we complete the list. The problem is, being an earth sign, as I am, we keep adding to the list. There's more and more to add to the list because that's who we are. An earth sign is that person who will wake up in the morning and within seconds or at least minutes, be thinking to themselves, if not talking out loud, and saying, okay, what is the plan today? You can tell an earth sign, because that is their first and foremost driving energy. What am I going to do today? What is the plan? That earth sign is the one who comes to the breakfast table, and when everybody else is just having a nice breakfast, the earth sign is going to be the one who's going to be saying, okay, so what's the plan today? And even if there is no plan, an earth sign will consider that that is a plan. You made a plan to do nothing today, so that's a plan. So earth signs are driven by making plans, making lists, carrying things out. They are the doers. They are the organizers. They are the ones who will organize everyone else. They're often the ones who will volunteer above and beyond anybody else. Yeah, I'll do it without even thinking sometimes. Yeah, sign me up. Yeah, put me down for that. These are the earth signs. The earth signs are those people who want to do something and to be involved, excuse me, with something. Now, the positives of an earth sign are, we're going to do the positives and negatives of all the soul groups. The positives of an earth sign are that we are the planners, that we do take action. But the danger of that is that sometimes earth signs can be just a little over-enthusiastic, and we can be considered, you know, a bit bossy, a bit, you know, controlling, a bit organizing, a bit, you know, move out of the way because here I come and I'll do it. And many times as an earth sign, especially if other people are in my kitchen, I have to bite my tongue and think, you know, stay out of it. It's not your issue. It's not your problem. But all the time I'm raring to say, can you move out of the way and just let me do this? So earth signs, the positive of an earth sign, I'm saying this to you, so all of you out there who have written in and say, I don't know what I am, all of you will, I'm giving you some basic, simple ideas of how you can, you know, sort of figure out what soul group you belong to. Because the important thing is you have to learn your soul group before you learn your soul sign. Okay, so the positives again of an earth sign are, we are the planners, we are the organizers, we are the doers, we are the first to raise our hand and volunteer for something, or sometimes I've been known to volunteer somebody else for something. But the danger of that, the danger is that we can become a little overzealous, or we can become really, really bossy and pushy and tend to walk all over other people a little bit in order to get done what we need to get done. When you are more aware of this, you're able to stop it. I don't think I walk all over people to get done what I need to get done. I found a way to encourage and to cajole people into doing what I'd like them to do. Okay, so let's come to those water signs. A water sign, the very first and the most important thing to know about a water sign, if you're a water sign, is you are the compromisers of the soul system. You are the ones who will find a way to compromise, to, if you like, to keep the peace, to, you know, to see other people's point of view much more easily. And that's a great thing, and that's a great attribute, because, you know, when you've got two people arguing about what they should do and a little water sign comes in and says, well, how about we do this first and then we do that next? How about that? We all need somebody like that, and a water sign is, that is their first instinctual thing, to find a way around things. Think of the river flowing, moving, finding its way around rocks and trees and over things and so on and so forth. That is a water sign, a compromiser. Again, the danger to a water sign is that you compromise to the point where you compromise yourself. You overcompensate, you overcompromise to the point where everybody else might be happy, but you're not. So that's the danger of a water sign. Okay, now we come to air signs, and the greatest attribute of an air sign is they're able to, you know, not get caught up in the fray. They're able to sort of float and move along, and whereas other people are perhaps arguing or fighting or getting irritated about things, the air sign is that person who really doesn't get too irritated by much. They kind of float along and so on and so forth. However, there is a danger, because when an air sign gets frustrated because they've floated along and tried to be the nice, you know, they are nice actually, you know, being nice and floating along and so on, the danger is that all of a sudden they might say enough of this, and they become passive aggressive. So they can be passive, woomph. And when an air sign has that woomph, everybody knows about it. But, you know, it's not good to be passive aggressive. So air signs do tend to be, you know, hold themselves in, to not let their emotions go, to float along nice and easily until all of a sudden they explode and everybody wonders, wow, what happened there? Okay. And finally, we come to those wonderful fire signs who, you know, we earth signs find really, really tough to deal with. A fire sign has so many fabulous attributes. They love to shine. They love to be nice and bright. They are the me, look at me souls, in a good way, in a nice way, very often. The danger is, you know, and they light up. They can really light up. And, you know, they're like, when a fire sign walks into a room, it's either wow or it's, oh God, here she comes. You know, it's because a fire sign is driven by their emotions, and they wear their emotions out there for everybody to see. So they can light up a room, or they can set fire to a room. And the danger of a fire sign is that they can burn themselves out by all of this, you know, brightness, or they can burn other people. So I don't know if that helps or hinders, but there we are. That gives you a little clue, a little taste of what kind of am I, you know. And you have to fit into one of these four groups. Everyone has to fit into one of those categories. Now, I know that there are these 12 fabulous soul signs within these four soul groups. But if you go for the soul sign and you read all of the attributes and all of the character traits of all of those 12 soul signs without first looking for your soul group, you will be so confused and you'll never find out who you are. But if you, first of all, go for which soul group am I? Am I an earth sign? Am I a fire sign? Am I an air sign? Or am I a water sign? Which am I? If you, first of all, figure out your soul group, then when you come to figuring out your soul sign, you only have three choices, because there are three soul signs within each group. So you have three choices. So instead of trying to figure out from 12, you're now figuring out from three. All right. Now, of those three, when you read the character traits of those three soul signs, you will immediately know which one you are not. Elimination. So by a process of elimination, you now have a choice of two. And then you work through it and you can easily find out which are you most like. Are you most like this one? Are you most like that one? So when you're looking at what soul sign you are and what soul group you are, you need to go for the group first. Otherwise, you will be confused. Once you know what group you are, and once you know what soul sign you are, life becomes so much simpler and so much easier. So let's deal with relationships. How do we build a relationship? If you are on your own and you're looking for a partner, it's easy, because now you know, once you know about soul signs, You know which soul sign is compatible to you, and you know which soul sign is not compatible to you. So when you meet people and you can judge them and you can look at them and you can listen to them and you can figure out what soul sign they are, you can immediately know if this soul sign is compatible with you or not. And no matter how tempting the package looks on the outside, it's not going to work, for instance, if you're an earth sign and this person you've just met is a fire sign. You need to run the other way. You can have friends. I have friends who are fire signs. Great. We get on great. But in relationships and in personal relationships, when you're living with someone 24/7, when you are trying to build a relationship with someone, earth signs and water signs are the most compatible. And those relationships have a really good chance of working out. Fire signs and air signs are very compatible. And if you're a fire sign and you meet an air sign, you're going to know that that air sign is going to feed you and nurture you and care for you. And by the same token, you are going to warm them and comfort them and inspire them. So air signs and fire signs are the most compatible. Earth signs and water signs are the most compatible. All right, so you're starting out, you're looking for a love interest. There are the basic rules. You know what you're looking for, roughly. You know what you're looking for once you know what your soul group is, okay? What about if you're already in a relationship, you're married, you're in this relationship, and you're an earth sign and he's a fire sign, and all you do is clash, because that's what's going to happen. What do you do then? Do you just run out and get a divorce, or are there ways that we can make it work, that we can build and make it work? I have very good friends. She is an earth sign, as I am, and her husband is a fire sign. And oh boy, when they were younger, did they, you know, really clash? But knowing about soul signs and understanding about soul signs has helped them to accept. She can't change him as much as she would want to, and as much as in the past she has tried, she cannot turn him into an earth sign. He's a fire sign. It makes her more reasonable, it makes her more understanding, and it makes her more tolerant. And he is so happy to be a fire sign, and he doesn't want to change, and he's so happy that now she's not trying to make him change, because he knows he can't change, but nor can he stop her or change her. So now he becomes more understanding, and he becomes more tolerant, and he becomes more aware. Is it a perfect relationship? They think so. It wouldn't work for me, and it might not work for other people, but it works for them, and it helps because they know what they're dealing with. So when he gets in that frame of mind, when he's sort of lighting up the room and setting fire to things, she's able to say, hold on, Mr. Fire Sign, calm down, and he's able to listen to her because he knows better and he understands and he knows himself more. So learning about your soul sign, learning about who you are, learning about your soul group is huge. And this doesn't just apply with love relationships, although it's very helpful when you're looking for a partner, when you're looking for a mate, but it applies also with your children. It applies, you know, how can you get through to one child but you can't get through to the other? You know, how come one of them listens to you and one of them doesn't? Are they compatible? That is their energy compatible with yours, or it does it clash against yours? So many things to think about, so many things that we, you know, that we need to learn about. But it's all there. It's all there in the explanation of soul signs. And all of this information was given to us by my spirit guide, Greg Eagle, who was able to help me to understand the pockets of energy that each soul was created from. Now, I just did a workshop at the weekend, last weekend, and one of the questions from somebody was, you know, well, can you change? If you're, let's say, if you're a warrior soul, as I am, let's say you're a warrior soul, can you change? Or when you die, do you become something else? Is it possible to change your soul sign? And I explain this by saying each of us, each soul is born into a certain pocket of energy, and that pocket of energy determines, it is infused into our soul, and it determines the character traits that we have. It determines the character traits of our soul. It determines who we are. And then our environment as we grow up and our upbringing either encourages those character traits or discourages those character traits. So we become more of who we are, or sometimes we become less of who we are. Okay, so, but can you change the basic character traits? Can you change a warrior soul, an earth sign, into a water sign, a peacemaker, say? Can we change them? And the answer is no. And I put it like this. Of course, you know I'm a cook, so we're going to do an analogy here. I'm making a cake. How about I'm making a fruit cake? I'm making a really rich, delicious fruit cake, as my Christmas cake was this year. Fabulous and delicious. And I put all of these ingredients into it, which all the flavors fuse together to create this fantastic cake. Can I change it into something else? Can I take some of the ingredients out and make it into something else? No. I can add to it. I can put cream on it. I can put a piece of cheese with it. I can make it more flavorful. I can make it more of what it is. Or I can just leave it out and neglect it and it becomes stale and moldy. But can I change the cake? No. Once a fruit cake, always a fruit cake. Once a water sign, always a water sign. Once an air sign, always an air sign. Once a fire sign, always a fire sign. And of course, once an earth sign and a warrior, as I am, always a warrior. And no matter, you know, how much we learn and grow, and when we leave this earth, and I know many of you believe in sort of previous lives and all of that. Okay, the soul is the soul. The earth sign is the earth sign and will remain so into eternity. And we can make more of that or we can make less of that. So it's very important, I believe, to know what you are, to know your soul group and to know your soul sign, so that every day when you meet new people, or when you're dealing with, you know, your family, or when you're, you know, sort of dealing with your children, you become more understanding because you understand them better. You understand more why you have this, you know, maybe a bit of aggression or, you know, angst between some people and some people you get along famously with. You understand why in a work environment you really can't tolerate this person, but yet you can tolerate this person. And you also understand why the person you can't tolerate, other people can tolerate perfectly well, because they're a different soul group, different energy, different soul signs, and it's all about our energies being compatible. Let's go to Carolyn, because I know we've got some questions coming in, and I know we have a couple of questions. We have a few questions actually that we had come in via email. So, Carolyn, let's go over to you. Are you struggling over there?
No.
Okay.
Excuse me. Say hi to Dickie from Nepal.
Hi, Dickie from Nepal. How are you?
And Peggy has a question.
Peggy, hi, Peggy.
You know,
I do know Peggy, yes.
Is there hope for a water sign and a fire sign? My mother is a fire sign and I am a water sign.
Well, think about the elements, okay? So you're a water sign, so you're flowing and you're moving and you're compromising. which is great for your mother because you're always going to find a way around things and you're going to find a way to move things and to try to make things work because that's who you are. You're a water sign. But remember the danger. Water signs, the danger for a water sign is to compromise themselves. Now, your mother being a fire sign is, you know, always going to be, you know, shining bright. It's always going to be about her and her emotions first. And that's what drives her. Her emotions drive her. But whatever you're prepared to compromise, you know, it can work. It can work well, except that remember, water can put out fire in an instant. So you have to be careful not to, you know, sometimes flood this relationship with too much water. But at the same time, you know, when you've got fire skimming across water, it can heat water to boiling point. So your mother can get you to a boiling point. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying, Peggy, but you must know that this happens. You must understand that this happens with you time and time again. You know, your mother might say something or do something and you can't help it. You feel yourself boiling up because fire heats water. If you understand that, you can change. You can, you know, you can say to yourself, okay, I'm not going to let what my mother does or says heat me up or boil me up or get me to boiling point because, you know, that's what she tends to do. And as a water sign, you are the compromiser, so you can actually make it better. Is she ever going to stop you getting to the boiling point? No, she's a fire sign. She's always going to be heating things up. Are you ever going to get to the point where, you know, you don't douse her? You can do that, but, you know, you need to understand what you're doing. And once you understand it, then you can be, you know, more accepting of your mother. She can be more accepting of you and you can have a better relationship. It will change if you want it to change, but will it change completely? No, you're always going to be struggling, Peggy. Sorry to say. Hope she understands what I'm saying there.
She says, yes, she can. Make me boil. And I'm a work in progress with her. Yikes.
Well, good luck with that then.
Dean said he wants the fruitcake recipe.
Always in the book, Dean.
That's what I told him.
If you're really nice to me, I'll let you have it sooner.
And then we've got Peggy says, good answer. Okay, we've got Serena who says, excuse me, I'm married to someone who I believe to be a narcissist and who lacks respect for me and who I am. He appears to be great on the outside, but has substance abuse issues and all of the personality disorders that go along with it. I'm not in a physically abusive situation, and he is a very loving and attentive father. Ending our marriage would be a no-brainer if we did not have two small children. I'm at a point where I've come to an understanding of who he is and who I am. It's all just a shame. I figure I can be patient and endure this marriage until the kids are a little older and I can go back to school. She's in her mid to late 40s. To get the training I need to support myself and our children. At this point, I've decided to move forward with love and compassion for him and especially for myself. And when I feel I've had enough and I am strong enough, I will then decide what my options are. Any advice from you would be so valuable to me at this time, as I am very uncertain of what sort of training I should seek or coping tools I should use. With so much love and gratitude, Serena.
Serena, thank you for sharing that with us. My heart really goes out to you with this because I think there's so many people like you in this similar situation. You know, you're staying for the kids. You're hoping, you know, for the best and so on. You know, I think that the fact that you're able to accept him for who he is and to, you know, and to be loving towards him shows that you have, you know, really a great soul and that, you know, you have a wonderful sensitivity. It will help you to figure out what soul sign you are and what soul sign he is, simply because when you look at the character traits, you know, it gives us much more understanding And so, you know, you've decided to stay with him. So it's not enough to just, in this is only my opinion, it's not enough to just, you know, put up with it and, you know, get on with it, because that is only going to cause more frustration and anger within you, which will inevitably come out from time to time. Because what you're doing here is suppressing. You're suppressing your emotions in order to, I think you use the word tolerate, you're going to tolerate it. And you know, as much as we love our children and we want the best for our children, I'm not suggesting that you leave him by any means, but I'm throwing this out to you, that your husband can be just as good a father and maybe better living elsewhere. You don't have to do this. There are ways and means that you don't have to do this. I don't want you to be a martyr, and darling, it sounds a little bit here as if you're putting yourself in that position where, you know, you're going to be a martyr and put up with this stuff. And I don't want to see anyone do that. If you know what soul sign he is and you know what soul sign you are, you actually can find ways and means to come together to find, you know, what his interests are and what your interests are. And you can find ways and means to come together if you're determined to stay with him and to, you know, to make this work for your children. You shouldn't be saying, I'm going to put up with it. Because your life is valuable too. And there are ways that you can not just simply put up with it, but live your life and have a happy life, even though you have these struggles. So finding your soul group and then your soul sign, you know, might just help you to understand him that little bit more and to actually start to like the things about him that are good. You know, it's when we start to really dislike our partners, when we start to dislike, I mean, I would hate to think that I would ever, you know, I've never been in a position where I would look at my child and dislike my child. I might dislike some of the things she might do from time to time in the past, but to dislike a person, and when you're living with someone and you're parenting together, but you don't like them, your children will know this. They will be aware of this. There'll be an atmosphere in this house. So you need to find a way, if you can, to, you know, look at the things about him that you do like and work on those and concentrate on those and build a relationship which is perhaps not based on, you know, the things that you initially based them on, but build a relationship where you can be friends. So at least, you know, your children will see that you are friends and you will not have that awful atmosphere that's in the house that inevitably comes from this, you know, kind of situation. If your husband is a narcissist, I mean, I could say he sounds like a fire sign to me, but if he's a narcissist, it's because, you know, there are things that have happened to him in his past that make him so. You know, I mean, it's so easy for me to sit here and say, if you can try and understand that and be sympathetic to him and all the rest of it, and I don't have to live in it. Whereas probably all you want to do is bat him across the head and say, pack it in. You know, tolerance is not, it's easy when you're not in that environment and not so easy when you are in that environment. But again, if you can figure out your soul sign and if you can figure out his soul sign, maybe there will be something in there that will help you to understand him, at least so that you can become friends and you don't have that frustration and anger that is building up inside you, which inevitably will build up inside of you, as you know, I'm sure you know. So I hope that helps you. I really do. Let's have our next question, shall we?
Happy New Year. Could you please perhaps discuss parent-children relationships and provide insight as to how to best navigate and survive the sometimes heart-wrenching journey of being a mother and a father? In circumstances where your child suffers through life's trials and tribulations in one form or another, despite how hard as parents we try to provide strength, unconditional, overwhelming love, hope, and guidance, recognizing that they will have their own lessons to endure. I feel it is in another category altogether, because a loving parent, in my opinion, would never give up, and they would go to the ends of the earth to protect their child and give them wings to soar so they can hopefully have the best life they can. But it is a hard, hard choice sometimes, knowing when to back off and pause and just have faith. Thank you so much, Lauren.
Hi, Lauren. Well, okay. That student never give up thing. Okay. If we think of those birds in their nest with those lovely little fledglings that, you know, there they are, and we're all going, oh, how nice, and so on and so forth. But we know in reality that there comes a point where the parents say, I've had enough of this, get out and fly. And sometimes a fledgling will do it all by themselves because they're eager to do it and they're eager to fly. But there are some fledglings who are going, no, I don't want to go. I'm comfortable here. This is very nice. I like this nest. Why should I go out and make my own nest? That's when the parent has to be tough and say, why? Because you have to learn to fly. It's very hard, you know. I know that there are a lot of mothers, and I do think that you're one of these wonderfully caring and loving people, Lauren, and I'm sure you're a wonderfully loving mother. However, there is this huge difference between mothering and smothering. And how do we know the difference? How can we tell, you know, when we should mother and when we are smothering? Because smothering is not going to do a child any good at all. And when you Or if you are smothering and then you stop smothering, it can be a bit of a shock to the child, I have to say. But when you stop the smothering and you become the mother, as we all should be and strive to be, you know, how do we know? How can we tell, you know, when is the right time? Well, instinct tells us, and, you know, other people can tell us, and also, you know, our kids can tell us by their attitude. You know, as parents, when you kick the kid out of the nest, you are actually not giving up. That is not the act of somebody giving up. When you allow them to stay in the nest because it's too hard or too difficult or too emotional or all the rest of those, all those reasons why that we give ourselves for not kicking our kid out of the nest, that is us giving up as a parent because it becomes too hard. And it becomes easier for us to just let it go than to actually be the parent and say, out you go, enough of this, out you go. I mean, it's difficult. And we all have to do what we feel is right for our children. I've never really been a smotherer, although I have sometimes been a little possessive and over possessive with my child and my grandchild. I'm the first one. If I think that, you know, there is some injustice coming along, but that's me as an earth sign, I'm going to be the first one to stand up and say this isn't right or that isn't right. But, you know, smothering, I mean, in this day and age, you know, every child has to have a cell phone. Every child has to have their own TV. I mean, I'm just as guilty of that. When, you know, my grandson had his third Christmas, I bought him a mini iPad. I mean, you know, we give them more than they need, actually. This Christmas, I had to talk to my daughter and say, don't you think you overdid it this year just a bit? And she looked me in the eye and said, well, I'm only going by what you did for me, which is very true. You know, so we give to our children, you know, much more than we should in material things. But we also have to make sure that when we're giving of our knowledge and our understanding and our wisdom as well. And honestly, you give a kid an iPad, you can have an iPad or you can have my wisdom. What are they going to say? They're going to say, well, I'll take the iPad. You as the parent have to say, no more iPad today, because now at this point, you've got my wisdom. At this point, we're going to sit as a family, we're going to be talking. So as we're giving to them in material ways, we also have to, as parents, have control over how they're going to use what we give them and how often they're going to use what we give them. And parents, I think today, find it very, very hard. They find it very, very tough to be able to draw the line and to be able to say, you know, I'm the parent and you're the child and you're going to do what I say you do. There was this whole spate of time, and I think, you know, we're still caught up in it in a way. You know, I hear parents saying all the time, but I want to be their friend. If you're a parent and you have this idea that you're their friend and you just want to be their friend, you can forget it, because you are not their friend until they become adult, they have families of their own, or they become grown-ups in their own right, and then you can be their friend. But the responsibility of a parent is not to be their friend. The responsibility of a parent is to be their father, their mother, the one who not only lays down the rules for the good and the sake of all of the family, not just that one kid. You lay down the rules, you have rules as a family. Of course, we all have rules. The first rule in a family should be that of respecting and respecting each other. And when you see a child not respecting, you as a parent need to demand that those rules be obeyed, that everyone in the family follows the rules, or havoc reigns. And if you're in a family, you're a parent of a family where havoc reigns, can't look to the kid and say, well, he's doing this and he's doing that. You have to look to yourself as a parent to say, you know, what do I need to do and what rules do they need to follow? And now how do I enforce those rules? I personally am a nurse and I've never had trouble in enforcing rules, not for myself or for anyone else. You know, I don't know, in this day and age of the kids on the computer, they're not listening, they're not paying attention to anything else. You see people, not just kids, adults walking down the street, they're on their headphones, they're texting, they're doing all of this stuff and they're not paying attention. You go into a restaurant, I was in a restaurant yesterday, do you know how many people I saw at their table sort of texting each other, ignoring the person they're sitting with, completely ignoring that person, texting on their phones, whatever it is that they're doing, and not paying attention to each other. As parents, you know, when we allow things to happen, when we give too much and, you know, and too easily, and we allow our kids to run roughshod over us, that's when we are giving up as parents, because it becomes too hard to be the one who's always saying, don't do this, you can't do that, here are the rules, follow them. That is hard, and that's what a parent needs to be. You know, what is it they say? An iron fist in a kid glove, but you have to have the iron fist, otherwise your kids are going to run roughshod all over you, and they're going to keep you on a string, like puppets on a string. I remember many years ago my daughter coming to see me. She'd left home at this point, and she came to visit, and it was coming up to Christmas time, and she said to me, Mama, I've decided that we shouldn't have anyone for Christmas this year. It should be just you and I, and her boyfriend at the time. It just should be us, and okay, we shouldn't have anybody else. And I said, well, I'm sorry, darling, but I've already invited people, and this is my house, and it's my Christmas. So she said to me, as children do, well, if you invite everybody else, I'm not coming then. Now, as a parent, what do I do? Do I cave in? Or because she expected me to? You know, our kids do that to us. They push us. They test us. They try us out. So I'm not coming. If you invite everybody else, I'm not coming then. I won't come. And Christmas, she knows, is my special time of year. So she knows perfectly well that she's going to destroy my Christmas if she doesn't come. But can I allow my child to dictate to me? Absolutely not. I'm the parent. This is my house. So I said, look, darling, I'm sorry if you feel that way. And I would really, you know, I really want you to come. But if you feel you can't, then that's your decision. And she sort of looked at me And there was this realization came across her face that it didn't work. My ploy to manipulate my mother didn't work. Kids manipulate. That's what they do. They test us. They push us. But we have to, as parents, stay strong and not allow them to manipulate us. And, you know, and the iron fist in the kid glove. So I love you very much, darling, but I'm inviting people for Christmas. Did she come? Of course she came, you know. But don't fall for your kids manipulating you. You know, it's tough being a parent. It really is tough. It's so much easier being a grandparent, I have to tell you. It's wonderful being a grandparent. I don't have to do anything but sit back. And now I have Christmas at my daughter's house, so she can do what she wants. She can invite no one or she can invite everyone. I'm just going to be there. That's, you know, and it's now, it's her choice now. It's her turn. It's her time. And that's what you have to give your kids when you push them out of the nest, when you allow them to fly and you stop allowing them to manipulate you, then they can grow. And then it's their turn. Okay.
Dean says he's wondering if you might have different views of this if you were a different sign.
Of course. Yes, Dean, yes. Well, I would hope. I mean, I'm not a different soul sign. I would hope I could see the reason and behind what I'm saying and the way that I parent. But the way that I have parented with my daughter and the way that I've, you know, I parent now and grandparent, I'm not sure if that's, you know, but anyway, the way I do that is through my own character traits, my own strength, my own development of those character traits. And of course, I am an earth sign. So I'm a planner. It happens, fortunately for me, I have to say, Dean, fortunately for me, it happens that my daughter is also an earth sign. And so we're very compatible and very much on the same page. We're already planning my grandson's fourth birthday party, the cake, the this, the that. And we've been doing it since Christmas, in fact, probably before Christmas, because that's who we are. We're the planners and the action takers. So, you know, in the parenting aspect, we're very similar. She, luckily for me, I'm not having to say to her, you shouldn't be doing this or that, because I'm pretty much in agreement with how she's, you know, how she's doing her parenting. But of course, yes, you know, a fire sign, for instance, you know, is going to run with their emotions, be driven by their emotions, is going to see the parenting as, you know, if the kid says, you know, I don't like you anymore, that poor fire sign is probably going to be desperately, desperately hurt. When my child said to me, as an earth sign, my child said to me when she was little, I don't like you, I don't like you anymore, which of course she did from time to time when the rules were strict, you know, I just shrugged my shoulders and say, well, too bad for you then. Because I'm not driven by my emotions, but a fire sign, yes, can manipulate, but can also be manipulated through their emotions. Once you know this, and once you know what you are and who you are, you can take steps to change it. You can't make it go away, but you can make it better or you can make it worse. You can, you know, make that Christmas cake, put toppings on the Christmas cake. I happen to put marzipan and royal icing on mine, just in case you want to know, Dean. But you can make it more delicious or you can make it less delicious. So each soul sign, you make yourselves more delicious or less delicious, more of what you can be or less of what you can be. Yes.
Peggy says that she's a water sign, but she agrees 100% with you on your child.
Well, yes, Peggy, you're a water sign, and you see earth signs and water signs are very, very compatible. We flow and we move along, and water feeds earth, and earth gives water a place to be and a place to flow and all of that good stuff. Yes.
And Karen's joining us.
Hello, Karen.
From Canada.
Oh, yes. Hi, Karen. Hi, yes. Darling. Yes.
And quick question, Sarah. from Chicago. We talk to her often.
Hello, Sarah from Chicago.
I believe this is the same lady who recently lost her mom and sent you.
Hi, Sarah. Thank you so much. You sent, for all of those of you watching, Sarah sent us a lovely email. You said some lovely things, Sarah. Thank you so, so much. I'm so glad that we were able to help you with your mother as she was in that process of passing. And we hope that we were able to inspire you to be more of who you are.
She would like to know, could you give her any ideas to distinguish between a peacemaker and an old soul?
Yes. This is good. Okay. So we're talking about water signs. So in that water sign category, we have the old soul, we have the peacemaker, and we have the seeker. Okay. So if you're wanting to know, you know, that you're looking at the old soul and the peacemaker, you've already dismissed the seeker. As I said earlier, of the three soul signs that you have a choice of, you will instantly say, no, that isn't me, to one of them. So that's what you're doing. The difference, basically the difference between an old soul and a peacemaker is the peacemaker will be all about family. Family first. The peacemaker is very family oriented. Now the old soul is also about family, but the old soul is also about nurturing others outside of the family. Not that a peacemaker doesn't do that, but primarily the main focus of the peacemaker is family, and the main focus of the old soul is, you know, much more expanded to family, friends, and so on. So if you are absolutely family oriented, your family comes first, last, and anywhere in between, you're a peacemaker. And you know, but if you are able to sometimes set your family's needs to one side because other things are more important, then you'll be leaning towards the old soul. I'm giving you this like a brief. Now, does that, Sarah, help you? Is she saying that it helps her in any way? Or does it confuse her? Because obviously she's deciding this for herself. So where is she now?
I haven't heard from her yet, but we're about a minute behind.
All right.
We're
okay.
Down to our last 8 minutes.
We're our last 8 minutes. Okay. So, okay. So what do we need now? Where are we now, young lady?
We can talk about what we're going to talk about. Oh, wait a minute. Okay. She says she's still confused.
Okay, well, typical water sign, you know, should I flow this way or should I flow that way? What I'm going to suggest you do, Sarah, is go through the character traits in the book. If you don't have the book, or if you're listening and you want the book, we are reprinting the book. It's going to take us, maybe, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks, maybe a month. But if you want the book, please feel free to email us, rosemary@rosemaryaltair.com. And you can pre-order the book. And as soon as we have it, you know, you'll be on the list to receive it. So if you email us, rosemary@rosemaryaltair.com. If you want to know any more about us, we are on Facebook. I've just started yesterday doing some little live. I found that little button, that little live button. Once I find a button, of course, I've got to press it just to see what it does. And so we're doing one or two little live things on Facebook. And we are going to try in the future to maybe have a few questions that, you know, question and answers on Facebook as well. We're going to see how that works out. Next week, what are we doing next week?
I believe we're going to continue. We are continuing
because we've had a huge response to this. So we are continuing a little bit on relationships. But join us next week. We will let you know what else we're going to be discussing and, you know, and where this subject takes us. But try and remember, everything is about energy and compatible energy and non-compatible energy make up the relationships that we have with every other person that we have, that we know on this planet. And it's important that we get it right. And it's important that if you're struggling in relationships, you can make them better. There are certain things that you can do, certain things that you can enhance about yourself to make things better. you can also make things worse. You can make things way worse. So you need to avoid the pitfalls of that. And soul signs is one way for us to avoid. Once we know what we're doing, soul signs is the way to avoid those pitfalls. So next week, we're going to be having more of a discussion, more of your questions coming in. We love having questions. Today, I'm going to make, or this afternoon, maybe today or tomorrow, I'm going to make a chocolate cake. I'm experimenting with, what am I experimenting with? I'm experimenting with sour cream. We're going to see how sour cream goes in a chocolate cake. Who knows what the result is going to be? I'll let you know about that. So you can find us on Facebook, you can find us on Twitter, and you can find us, of course, on YouTube. Here we are. And anywhere else they can find us here. And no, anything else going on there? No, that's it. So in the meantime, until next week, please, please, please have a blessed, blessed day. Thank you for joining us.